Good afternoon and welcome to Midday Moms. This is Dorothy Pilarski, and I'd like to welcome you and thank you for joining us today. And as you're signing on, I would ask that you say hello to us in the chat there on the right-hand side and tell us where you're from. You know, you could say, hello, I'm Helen from Halliburton, or I'm Kathy from Conestoga, wherever you're from, just tell us where you're from and tell us how many kids you have. Tell us if you stay at home, if you're working, if you're on holidays. Hello, Rema Celio. Rema is one of our mother's group leaders from St. Benedict's in Etobicoke in Canada. So welcome, Rema. Great to have you here. So a big warm welcome to each of you. We have a very, very special guest today, Emily Jaminet. I'm a big, big fan. I've got her book, Divine Mercy for Moms. I've got her book, The Friendship Project. And so it's such an honor to have her here all the way from Ohio. Emily, Thank you so much for joining us. Can you tell our moms just a little bit about yourself as they're signing on?
Well, hello, everyone. Hello, aloha as well. I am always from the United States. I grew up here in Ohio. I came from a family, small family of four kids, and I'm parenting seven, so 22 to five. I am an author, speaker, and I'm a director of a ministry. So I was a stay-at-home mom for many years, and I've transitioned really into full-time ministry work as and juggling motherhood. So that's full-time.
Yeah, I was reading your bio. Can you tell me again, how many children do you have? You've got
seven children.
You've got seven children. And just before we went live, you were telling me how the range of age of your kids, which got me on the edge of my seat. Can you tell the moms here just how many, like, what's the age range? It kind of blew my mind, honestly.
Well, Dorothy, I've been mothering for many years, you could say. My children span 22 to five. So I was back at, you know, meet the teacher, meet the kindergarten, preschool teacher, you know, as I have kids that are, you know, in upper grades of college. So I've been able to see mothering trends now for over 22 years. So it's really something I'm so excited about, Catholic motherhood and the gift to be able to give back like today.
Yeah. Well, it's, you know, it's really beautiful just to see your radiance too, you know, like it just, the radiance and joy really, really shines through. So thank you so much for joining us. And we really do look forward to just gleaning some wisdom from you. I wanted to say hello to a few other people that have joined us. We've got Melissa from Oakville. Hey, Melissa, you know, someone contacted me the other day and said, oh, do you have a mother's group in Oakville? We do have one mom that's suggesting that she might start one, but Melissa, are you being called to start a Catholic mom's group? Lynette, aloha from Hawaii. I had the great privilege of delivering the workshop, How to Start a Catholic Mom's Group, actually in Hawaii. It was one of the greatest days of my life. I really had a lot of fun. I love Hawaii. I've been there several times. Hi, Lynette. Thanks for joining us. Hello, Linda, Roselle, Claude. Great to see you again. So thank you, everybody. Oh, Ellen. Hi. It's great to see you, Ellen from Annunciation Parish. All of you, a big, big, big warm welcome. We do want to tell you a little bit about our Catholic Moms Group ministry. So again, if you want to learn more about us, we encourage you to visit our website. I always say it's really easy. It's three words, Catholic Moms Group. So catholicmomsgroup.com. We are faith partners with the Archdiocese of Toronto, and we are on a mission to revive the vocation of motherhood. And we do so primarily by helping parishes start Catholic moms groups. And I'd like to share with you a 3-minute video that highlights the work that we do. And we hope that someone here is called to start a Catholic mom's group. So let me just show you our very short video. And so So if you visit our website, Catholic Moms Group, you can find out all about us. We can help parishes start three types of groups: groups for moms only, for moms in tots, or virtual groups. When you join our ministry, or we're accepting at this point applications, we can help start a moms group, a moms and tots groups, or a virtual meetup. Again, we are faith partners with the Archdiocese of Toronto. Right now, we're also working with the Archdiocese of Hamilton, the Archdiocese of St. Catharines, and the Diocese of Peterborough. And so let me share with you our short 3-minute video.
Mothers, by our very nature, we are nurturing, loving caregivers. We are social beings, made for friendship and community. We are also spiritual by nature, made by a loving God to know Him and love Him, and to pass this love of our Catholic faith on to our children. But right now, many mothers feel overextended, distracted, and exhausted. Though as Catholics, we have the community of our church, many mothers attending Mass could not name the mom sitting next to them in the pew they share. Community and support among Catholic mothers is desperately needed in this hectic and chaotic culture. Your parish needs you to bring these moms together.
Hi, my name is Dorothy Pilarski. I'm the founder of Catholic Moms Group. We at Catholic Moms Group are on a mission to revive the vocation of motherhood. We exist to bring together like-minded, faith-filled mothers who crave community and are focused on spiritual growth, Catholic teaching, and fellowship. Can you imagine a thriving, engaged mothers group at your parish? A group of moms in love with their Catholic faith, ready to serve other mothers no matter what stage of motherhood they're at. Can you imagine what a difference that would make at your parish? Starting a mother's group, it's not rocket science, but working with a team who's done it before and who's done it dozens and dozens of times sure does help. The Catholic Moms Group membership site is an online community that offers training, resources, and dozens of tools for parishes to help them start a mother's group quickly and efficiently. We're here to provide you with a clear path to launching a Catholic Moms Group at your parish. All of our materials are 100% Catholic. We have clearly laid out meetup plans for both moms groups and toddler groups. We are obedient to the magisterium of the Catholic Church. We have created dozens of tools that are going to save you time and energy. And besides that, we love our Blessed Mother. We constantly turn to her for her intercession. You can make a huge impact in your parish, so join us. We are revolutionizing the way parishes start mothers' groups by providing parishes with a Catholic Mothers' Group starter kit and by nourishing and training a community of Catholic Mothers' Group leaders across the world. It's time to start a mothers' group at your parish. Join us today. Last night, it was such a beautiful evening. Oftentimes, mother's group leaders will kind of text me or something after one of their mother's group meetings. And yesterday, I was talking to our mother's group leader in North Pole, Alaska. I was talking to our mother's group in Indiana, our mother's group leader in Brooklyn, and then I was talking to another mother's group leader in Clarkson. And our Blessed Mother, like I always want to acknowledge publicly our Blessed Mother, because what she has been doing through this ministry has honestly just been blowing me completely away. So I always like to thank our Blessed Mother publicly, because if it wasn't for her intercession, oh my gosh, our ministry now is in its seventh year. We've got a mom's group in Wales. We've got a mom's group in Mississippi, and we've got a mom's group in Minnesota. So anyway, I like to thank our Blessed Mother. And if you have any problems or concerns, bring them all to our Blessed Mother, because what I've seen her do truly I don't even know what the word is about my Catholic faith, because what has happened has just been miracle after miracle. And really having, you know, Emily here is another one of those miracles. So I'm really, really delighted to have Emily here. I want to tell you a little bit more about her. Emily Jaminet is on a mission too, to help Catholics to be impacted by the love of Christ in their hearts and in their homes. She is a Catholic author, speaker, radio personality, and mother of seven children. She co-authored the award-winning and Catholic bestseller, Divine Mercy for Moms, along with The Friendship Project. And the most recent book is The Secrets of the Sacred Heart. 12 ways to claim Jesus's promises in your life. Emily writes regularly for the diocesan.com, catholicmom.com. She's executive director for the Sacred Heart Enthronement Network. And she began her ministry work offering a daily segment called A Mother's Moment. She's been on EWTN, and now she can say she's been on Midday Moms. Oh, I was just having fun with you. So a big, big, big warm welcome. Emily, thank you so much for joining us. Can you tell us a little bit about why you decided to write this book, The Secrets of the Sacred Heart?
Oh, Dorothy, thanks so much for having me on. It's such a joy to have a midday break with you. You know, Secrets of the Sacred Heart is really near and dear to my heart. I felt like we, you know, needed a book to help explain this beautiful devotion to the heart of Jesus and to give people hope in the times that we live in. And the 12 promises of the Sacred Heart are such a powerful way to grow closer to Jesus. It's a roadmap to come to live out your Catholic faith and to give you the graces that you need. So I love the word in my title, claim the promises, because what I want to do is encourage people to claim these beautiful, you know, promises of the Sacred Heart and to go deeper in their faith, to trust Jesus and to experience his love, so you can have a spiritual heart transplant and be transformed and impact everyone around you. So that's it, Dorothy.
Your radiance and joy are just such a testament to what you said. It's obvious you've had a heart transplant. Oh my gosh. It's so obvious. So can you tell us a little bit about the Sacred Heart? Can you tell us a little bit about
it? Well, my personal story is really unique. I'm actually technically third generation Sacred Heart. My grandfather worked with the Men of the Sacred Hearts during his retirement in Cincinnati, Ohio, where he made these little plaques of the Sacred Heart and the Immaculate Heart. And he did this for pretty much the 30 years of his retirement. And he did this out of his basement, and he had the images. He would package them, and then they would be shipped out to Albania and India, where they would go into the homes of the sick and dying for Mother Teresa. So this amazing thing is happening in my family. And yet it really didn't get on the forefront of my mind until Mother Teresa sent him a birthday card thanking him for all of his work. And at the time I was a teenager. I'm like, what is Grandpa doing in his basement, right? Like, what is my grandpa doing? He was just a simple man, humble man, beautiful grandparents, huge devotion to the Immaculate Heart, Sacred Heart. And then about 10 years after he passed, my parents began a local apostolate here in Columbus, Ohio, to also promote the Heart of Jesus, the devotion to the Sacred Heart. all throughout homes through the enthronement of the Sacred Heart here in my city. So we had over 2,500 homes have been enthroned to the Sacred Heart. This amazing revival has taken place and I've seen the fruits. And the first thing I did is I told my parents, I'm like, I got to start writing about this. This is so cool. Like I wrote an article in one of the Catholic Digest and I just thought, what they're doing is unbelievable. These volunteers helping with this. And just next thing you know it, once you notice something, God then tapped you on the shoulder. And so I began volunteering. Then I stepped into the director role. Then I wrote a book because I just wanted to get the hope, the message of hope out to others and really share, you know, that everyone can be first generation Sacred Heart, right? Everyone, every day is a new day. And the image that we're talking about is the image you have behind you. This is the image that is similar to the one sent to the homes of the sick and dying, the image of the Sacred Heart, and just help people see how much God loves them. So that's a little bit of my personal testimony, but the devotion is rooted back into the amazing apparitions that took place in the 1670s by St. Margaret Mary Alico in France in a time where Jansenism was rampant, where people felt so unworthy. They were not even receiving communion because they were just so overwhelmed by their humanity that they could never imagine that God loved them so much as to pour his heart out and to have that relationship with them. So as a result from these apparitions, this devotion just spread like wildfire. And from that, the 12 promises were really solidified. There's many more promises, Dorothy, than 12, if you read her writings, but these are the summary. And my favorite is the first promise, which is that he shall give us grace necessary for our state in life. So moms, good news, grace is there for you, no matter how old you are, how difficult your kids are, whatever your trials are, it's there for you. So.
Yeah, no, it just, and some of you might not know this about me. I'd been mentioning to Emily before we came on, is that, you know, I basically have had the same spiritual director since, 1989, and he's a priest of the Sacred Heart. And my very first consecration was to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And it was him that introduced me to the promises of the Sacred Heart. And when I look back on my life, I was hospitalized on an emergency basis just before my first Holy Communion. And a priest came to visit me. And lo and behold, you know, what image did he bring? What gift did he bring? He brought a picture. I often feel like the Sacred Heart of Jesus has been kind of almost, you know, chasing me. And then I forget exactly what year it was, but the sisters, Mother Teresa's sisters, what are they called? Those sisters, remind me again.
The Sisters of Charity.
There you go. I always get these bleeps for that. Yeah. So the Sisters of Charity, they actually came to our home, and they came to our home with a priest, and that priest heard all of our confessions. He heard my confession, John's, Monica and Michael's, and they did a, you know, quote unquote, official enthronement of the Sacred Heart of Jesus in our home. And we have a little room. It's off to the side, just off to the side of the kitchen. And we call it our Mummy Mary room. And so we usually keep our statue of our Blessed Mother there. And we have the picture of the Sacred Heart there. And of course, we have a number of relics. And so the enthronement of the Sacred Heart has, you know, been a huge, huge part of my journey. It didn't begin with my grandfather as yours did. Can you tell us a little bit about what an enthronement is? Like, what actually is that?
Yes.
How can you make
that happen? Yes, I'd love to tell you about that. So in 1907, I'd love to try to rewind my mind to 1907. The state of the world was one where to us, it might've seemed like, you know, sunny days and everything's great, but to Father Mateo, a priest in Chile, was really noticing the impact of secularism and modernism on the family unit. He saw the family being torn apart from farming and poverty and just beginning to see that wave, which we now experience every day. So in a state of prayer, he actually went to the same convent of where St. Margaret Mary Alacoque was in France. He was kneeling down and praying, and he actually had a physical ailment. His back was, he had a bad back. He was very frail. He had been in this earthquake, and he was on his way to pilgrimage to Rome, and just kind of in this place of discernment. So as he was in this chapel of St. Margaret Mary Alacoque's chapel, he was praying. He had a physical healing, and he had a moment of inspiration. And he said, imagine if every Catholic, right, took the image of the Sacred Heart, had it installed in their home, and they exposed and honored it. Because that's one of the promises. If you expose and honor the Sacred Heart, you shall be blessed. And so the word enthronement is to enthrone him on high. If you read Psalm 102, you know, it even says enthrone him on high. And this word enthronement is all throughout the scriptures, especially the Old Testament, as a beautiful reminder that he wants to be king of our heart. So he said, what if this happens? What if this, if families just start placing the image and start trusting and start, you know, really, really turning to the Sacred Heart? And at the time, the Pope, so then he went to Rome. He had an audience with the Holy Father, and the Holy Father, he told him all about this idea of enthronement. He said, I do not give you permission. I command you to make this your life's work. And that's what exactly what Father Mateo did. The rest of his priesthood, which he thought was going to be a one-year mission, was a 40-year mission, promoting all around the globe. He went to Canada, United States, all through Europe. And at one point he said, which was so striking to me, he was touring the destruction of World War I, which we know, trench warfare. It was so awful. The cities were so just destroyed. The families destroyed. And he said, I want you to know that every single time a family splits up, a mother and father split up, it's more painful than all of this. And he just had this sensitivity, this love for the family that we have easily lost, right? And yet at the same time, he gives us the hope that our Lord always restores, renews, and revitalizes, you know, all families. So maybe the changes have taken place. And I can tell you, families have come back to me after doing the enthronement. So first, it's not a sacrament. It is a devotion. So devotion, meaning it could be done self-led, like we promote at welcomeisheart.com. It could be overseen where a priest comes, like you shared, or people witnessing with you. It could be, you know, just you in your bedroom. You know, maybe your husband is not supportive of your faith. You're doing this in a place where you're saying, like in the words of Joshua, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. But somebody's got to say it. Somebody's got to give their heart and their home to Jesus, open the front door and let him in and have that holy image as a reminder, a holy stop sign to spend some time with the Lord and give him that opportunity to work.
You know, I'd like to ask you, you know, just before we came online, and this is, I'm very, very inspired, not only by your faith and your radiance and, you know, being the mother of seven children, writing three books, and now executive director to, you know, an organization that's wanting to, you know, to propagate the devotion to the Sacred Heart. How is it that you came to becoming so open about your Catholic faith, about, you know, because not the average Catholic mom, you know, isn't working in the vineyard. I always say, you know, the average Catholic mom is kind of still sometimes deciding whether or not she agrees with everything the Catholic Church is teaching. And we all know a lot of kind of, I call them, you know, not only me, but cafeteria moms. What kind of led you to just laying it all down? Can you tell us a little bit more about that? Because I'm just, you know.
Yeah, I think first and foremost, you can't give what you don't have, right? You can't give what you don't have. And love is something, you might have all the money in the world. You might have, like you said, the career of a lifetime. But every Catholic mom, when you are given that baby and you are leaving the hospital, you have a tremendous responsibility, and you can't rely on your love. You need to receive that love from God so that it can go forth and radiate to your family, to your, in your marriage. And I think there are opportunities, you know, like to pause and reflect on those gifts. And I was very blessed in an amazing Catholic family. My brother's a priest. My parents were very involved in ministry, but every one of us in the quiets of our hearts has that moment where we have to choose to let God in. And for me personally, you know, we have those little opportunities. And then I can think back, Dorothy, to the moment where my mother brought me the image of the Sacred Heart. She's like, Emily, this is such a beautiful devotion for your family. I put the image up. I was busy, like, great mom, but I'm so busy. But there was a moment that night where I kneeled down, and I recommend this for every Catholic mom. And I said, okay, Jesus, you can have the marriage, the family, and my future, right? And when you entrust Jesus with everything, in return, he blesses you 100-fold. And oftentimes we start the conversation in the wrong way. We start the conversation about faith with all the you shouldn'ts, or, oh, don't do this and don't do that as a Catholic, instead of telling them, hey, you got a lifeline. It's the love of Jesus. And from that love, you can get through the worst day of your life times 100 every single day. And in the end, there's eternity. So there's always hope no matter what. So this is what kind of got me just extra excited, because I felt like Catholic moms weren't hearing that. I felt like I would do all these studies and I would learn all the rules. But like I said, I'm on a mission to promote the love of God in hearts and in homes. And once you encounter the love of God, you don't want to go back. You don't want to go back.
Yeah. And I know that when I, you know, I had my very first child, I always said, you know, I never sinned more and I never needed confession more, because, you know, like, you're faced with your limits when you've got this, you know, screaming baby and your husband's gone on a business trip and you were the baby in the family. And so, you know, I remember once having, you know, I thought, how can I get the word out to moms that if the only thing they ever did each and every day was to go to mass, they would get everything they wanted, right? Like, can you imagine? What a different world it would be if moms were in a position to do that, just to daily, literally feed off of the body and blood of Christ, and everything else will be, you know, taken care of. And so, you know, motherhood does bring us face to face with our own neediness. And I really, really love what you're saying too, about that you can't give what you don't have. And, you know, as Catholics, we're so blessed because there are so many devotions in the Catholic Church. You know, there's the Divine Mercy Chaplet. There's, you know, the Sacred Heart of Jesus. I know that one thing that really helped me in my, you know, Catholic faith too, was the Holy Spirit seminar. What's it called?
Oh, yes. The baptism in the Holy Spirit. Life in the Spirit. Yes.
The life in the Holy Spirit. And so, you know, no matter where you are in your Catholic faith, no matter where you are in your journey, I always say that God plops something in front of us to bring us to that next stage. And I've got to tell you that one of our mothers groups is actually right now studying your book, The Secrets of the Sacred Heart. Now, do you have in the back of that book, is there a discussion guide there? Is there?
Oh, you know, you are just saying such great things. There is at AveMariaPress.com. There is a free journal I put together that has the discussion questions. But, you know, the thing about this devotion is, like we were saying, with God's love, right? It's very personal. And every other, one of my books, The Friendship Project, Divine Mercy for Moms, Prayfully, it was, you know, a lot of great dialogue, but I felt like we also needed sometimes to have those questions first with ourselves and then to have them, you know, with others. So my favorite thing is when people do it as a book club. There's a group in Florida. I'm going to speak at a parish and I was so encouraged that they're doing it, and a group in Michigan, but I also said, you gotta encounter his love. So not just answer the right question. So a lot of the women go through the discussion questions as a group, but you know, a lot of times they said to me, Emily, I took this book to confession, or I took this book to adoration, because I needed to slow down enough and contemplate the love of God in a way that was a little different than getting, you know, the right answer or not. So if that helps, it's set up a little differently, but it works really well for group study as well.
Yeah. And one of the things for those of you that are, you know, part of our Catholic Moms ministry, if you go into the resource section, we do have a Sacred Heart booklet. It's the Litany of the Sacred Heart, because every single Thursday, I don't know for how many years, you know, oh, Sacred Heart, oh, love divine. I just love that. I would, you know, pray the Litany at Nativity of Our Lord Mass. So that is available to you. But one of the things that was sort of propelled me in this ministry, and I'm sure it's propelled you, Emily, too, is that, is it fair to say that many moms, because of our current cultural model of motherhood, that many moms, many people have actually hardened their hearts in order just to cope? Right.
Yeah. So
in order to cope, I've put this armor around my heart. And I always say that if a mom has a hardened heart, well, how's that going to affect her relationship with herself? And how's that going to affect her relationship with her children? Like, you know what it's like when you're dealing with someone that's hardened their hearts, right? Like, so do you have any thoughts on that? Like,
Dorothy, thank you so much for bringing that up, because it's so true. What's really important, you know, about this devotion, and you brought up, there's so many options, so many beautiful devotions. First, you know, I got to say the Divine Mercy devotion is pouring forth. Those rays come from his heart. You know, this devotion, the heart is the, it's more than the symbol. It's everything Jesus. It's also Eucharistic heart. So when you go before the image of the Sacred Heart, it reminds you of Jesus at Mass. It's the same heart, you know, it builds up your faith. St. Gertrude shared in the 12th century that this devotion would be for end times, when hearts would grow cold and need renewal. I can't remember the exact quote, but it's definitely, I have her book. And but the point is, it is for now, because anyone could agree we are dealing with a hard-hearted society, right? And mothers never before have had such conflicted hearts, such hard-heartedness, that this is how you can get that reset button. This is how you can get that, like I said, spiritual heart transplant is so important, because you have to let Jesus in so that he can show you where you need healing, where you need to grow, what virtues you need in your life. It might be self-control. It might be to control your temper. Moms, we got to strive for holiness. And in that, your example does matter. A lot of times people will say, oh, it's okay, you just had a bad day and you screamed at the kids. No, it's not okay, right? You need to go before the Lord and ask for that spiritual heart transplant so that you can grow closer to Jesus and better resemble the love of Christ. And no mom's perfect, Dorothy. No mom is perfect. But the hard-heartedness of this culture is making it really hard to see and to cope and to deal with our marriages and our relationship with our children. And ultimately, what I love about, one of the things I love about the enthronement, is it's a new beginning for you and your family so that healing can take place. And ultimately, you can deal with what you need to deal with. So, you know, it doesn't mean that your cross is just going to be wiped away, but this book gives you a perspective on your trials and gives you that renewed hope that, you know, Jesus is going to show up, because our hearts are where the kingdom lived.
I'll be honest with you. I haven't gotten the book yet, but I'm definitely, after chatting with you, I'm definitely going to go on Amazon and hit that click button and order it, read it over Christmas. And I encourage everybody here to do the same. One thing too, that I just really, really love about the devotion to the Sacred Heart is that you know, like our Lord makes so many promises to us. And I don't think that we don't often enough kind of claim the promises. Like, you know, Jesus promised that whoever had this picture in their home and honored that picture, that there would be peace in their homes. Like, who doesn't want more peace in their homes? Can you tell us a little bit more about some of the promises? I know that we don't have time for all of them.
Sure.
We want people to get the book after all.
Well, someone asked in the chat what book we're talking about. So it's called Secrets of the Sacred Heart, 12 Ways to Claim Jesus's Promises in Your Life. So this book is a summary of hope. Like, if you need hope, this is the book for you, because each chapter, there's 12 chapters, breaks down each promise. And part of it was, when I encountered the promises, was I was a young kid. I saw the list of promises. I thought, well, why did no one ever tell me this? Like, you know, I will give you graces for the state in life. I will establish peace in your home. I will comfort you in your afflictions. These are really strong statements. So in each chapter, I look at, well, what is the scripture that reinforces this? Because none of this goes against the gospels. It all affirms what Jesus preached, what he said in his ministry. The difference is, you know, like I said, the devotion of the Sacred Heart is like a roadmap. And it's not just our generation. It's all generations before us. Think of the number of Catholics, the number of Polish Catholics, the number of German Catholics, you know, American Catholics, the Irish Catholics that place their trust. I just got a letter last week in all Spanish from a man incarcerated in the southern United States. And he said, the whole letter was in Spanish. And he told me all about his village, where he grew up, and how, no matter how poor people were, he said, everyone had an image of the heart of Jesus because everybody trusted his heart. So this is worldwide global influence of what used to be normal in Catholicism. This wasn't just, I didn't make this up, but the idea of peace in the home is really important. This is not peace from video games, silence, everybody's quiet, plugged in peace, right? Dorothy, if you've ever had that moment where the whole house is quiet because everybody's plugged in, right, moms? And then all of a sudden you unplug and you're like, oh my gosh, that was crazy. Why did I even let them, you know, watch all that TV? Why is wrapping presents? The truth is, this is peace that only God can give us, right? He tells us in John 14:1, do not let your hearts be troubled. That's what he wants to do. Is he wants to solve our problem of troubled hearts, of being overwhelmed, of being anxious. So we have peace even in the midst of the storms of our life, even in the midst of trials, even in the midst of unemployment, unexpected pregnancies, whatever that is, that trial, he's going to give you that grace. So this devotion is not just, oh, am I a good Catholic because I have the image on the wall? This devotion is your lifeline to living out your Catholic faith in the messiness of your own home. That's how I view it, in your own home. You got to have holy stop signs like Jesus in your home.
Yeah, I know that a couple of people have brought it up in the chat, and it's, it's a topic that I think that is close to everyone's mind right now, is, you know, the pandemic and COVID and, I don't know, I guess there's information coming out about this new variant. And I was, you know, sitting there in the kind of Mother Mary room and in front of, you know, the Sacred Heart of Jesus with my relics. And I was sitting there and praying, and I'm like, oh my goodness, are we going to be closed down again? Are there going to be new restrictions? And the one thing that I really felt that, you know, God or Jesus, I don't know exactly who was saying to me, is that, you know, in a way that this is really, really an opportunity for more prayer, you know. So it's the kind of message came to me, you know, Dorothy, rather than freaking out and, you know, worrying, and rather than, going on some type of rant, really, you know, why not take this as an opportunity to spend more time in scripture, more time in spiritual reading, more time, maybe instead of doing the rosary once during the day, maybe do the rosary two or three times a day. And so, it's almost as if the spirit of the world is, attacking us more and more during this pandemic. And I'm kind of thinking that enthronement and, reading your book might be an excellent opportunity to reestablish the home as the domestic church again. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I think that's really a beautiful reminder of a conversation I had with Father Stosh Daly, our spiritual director and one of the founders of this whole movement in the United States in Columbus. And he said to me, as the Israelites placed the blood right above the mantle for the passing of the spirit of death in their home, he said, enthronement is literally saying, Jesus, you can reign here. It's opening the door, in Revelations, he's knocking. Open the door, let Jesus in. And like I shared in that prayer I had, you can have the marriage, the children, the career, you can have everything, Jesus. Like, he will work and he will work miracles in your life. Because for most of us, we might feel really good most of the day until we have to deal with our Catholic mothering, right? That's what really, I'm not a good mom or this isn't going well. This idea of enthronement is such a spiritual protection over the family, and that we don't get short-term vision, but we have a very clear roadmap that heaven is our goal. We want to stay calm in our storms. We want peace in our family. We need grace for our state and life. The image again is a holy stop sign where you got to stop and talk to Jesus, like you said, having that dialogue. And lastly, the reason why every Catholic mom needs to do the enthronement, and we have materials at welcomeisheart.com. I have a digital download, Dorothy, so we can get this across the border. Let's do it. It's a little expensive. When I ship to people, I'm like, can you just please pay the shipping? Because it's expensive to ship to Canada. But that's one reason why we have a digital download. And but what's really, really exciting for me is he's going to reveal what you need to focus on. And for a lot of moms, their head is right in the sand. Like, they're thinking, I need coffee. I need to go to work. I got to come home. Darn it. I got to cook dinner. There's a real just got to do. But as a Catholic mom with the eyes of the Sacred Heart, with his heart helping you, you're going to see what you need to see. You might see that lonely child that might just need, a new environment to really thrive. You might see that child that has different struggles that you were completely unaware of. And one of the ways that we learn what our children are struggling from is from family prayer. So we don't just want to place the image on the wall, get a decorator, choose where it goes. Everything looks great. I'm done. No, it's then pulling your family together and always reminding them that God loves them. We do a beautiful prayer on our website, welcomeisheart.com. I have it in the book, the Holy Heart of Jesus prayer. This idea of trusting your family, teaching them to pray to the Sacred Heart, entrustment, share their intentions, ask your children to share their intentions. And a lot of times you're going to learn what's going on at school, what's going on with the neighbor kids, what's going on, even your own marriage, hearing it and then having the grace to not be angry, but to respond with love. So that's what gets me excited about, even if we go back into COVID-19 lockdown, we can't control that, but we can control what's going on in our own house.
Do you have a word for, because like in a word meaning some consolation or some thoughts for, moms whose maybe adult children or older children are kind of maybe indifferent to the Catholic faith? Because, I know in my home it's like, okay, there's my religious mother, and some of us that have been very, very enthusiastic about the faith maybe have alienated some of their kids because of their enthusiasm. And it's kind of like, okay, you do you. They're kind of going through the motions or maybe not going through the motions, or maybe have completely left the faith. Do you have any words for moms who are very passionate about their faith, but they've hit the wall with, either their husbands or their kids? Do you have any thoughts for them?
Yeah, I do. I think you bring up such a delicate issue that we all, at some point are going to have a sword in your heart, right? Like, you don't get through motherhood without some battle scars. And this is one that's very near and dear to us. But I want to say, don't have a short-term vision on this. Like, a lot of times we fall into despair and anxiety and stress, and we think it's all on us. Like, what, you know, we take the self-blame. Instead, I really want to call you to this higher living where you say, I'm going to radiate so much love, so much joy. I'm not going to not practice my faith. I'm actually going to practice my faith more, but I'm going to do it in a way that inspires them by my actions. So we might not be able to talk about it, you know, every little, you know, idea of debating, you know, catechesis, but maybe you have an amazing faith story to tell them that, you know what, this week, this is what happened to me. There was a healing at this, you know, my friend's child was healed, you know, at a prayer service. Like, share the high points of that, but it's all about, you know, removing that bitterness, the anger, you know, the frustration of motherhood, for us with children that are older, you know, we might feel a little just burdened. The holidays might remind us of all the giving and giving and giving we've given and the little bit of gratitude that's been received. But if we keep our eyes on the Sacred Heart, right? We have mothers, we've been packaging, and, you know, I mean, that's a little near and dear to me.
No, thank you for that. A lot of moms approach me, you know, talking about people that have, you know, left the faith and so on and so forth. And I also wanted to thank you so much about that, about seeing our children in different ways. And, you know, that just because family members are plugged into devices and it's quiet, that doesn't mean it's authentic, you know, and joyful peace. I guess it's an issue that's, you know, very, very close to my heart is I've been blessed with a daughter who, you know, it's been a very kind of gifted relationship, and that sometimes in the past we'll have gone to mass and she'll say, Mom, you know, you see that girl over there that's at church? Well, her mom is, like, you know, sitting there praying the rosary, praying. She has no idea that her daughter is actually a lesbian on Instagram. Or, you know, sometimes they'll go, oh, you know, Mom, and she would tell me stories, and it just became so clear to me that so many moms, even though all of the family members are in the house, that the members to one another are strangers, you know? Mm-hmm. And one of the missions behind the Catholic Moms Ministry is to somehow, and it came to me last year, so it's really interesting that our paths are coming together now, is that the answer was consecration to the Sacred Heart and enthronement to the Sacred Heart, because mothers, sometimes they're so, you know, sometimes mothers are volunteering too much. Sometimes they belong to too many committees and too many apostolates, and they don't know what favorite color their son's favorite color is, right? And so I keep on, you know, I have been begging our Lord, you know, to show me, like, what can we do as a ministry to make sure that mothers have a heart for their children again? Because it's almost as if, well, let's shuffle him off to hockey and let's shuffle her off to jazz and let's shuffle off my husband to work. And we shuffle everyone off and then get so involved in ministry, and that there isn't this, that there isn't this unifying force in the family. And it came to me that, you know, that this, you know, and I've done a consecration to our Blessed Mother, and, you know, and so I'm just really, really grateful that our paths have crossed again. And I haven't read your book, but I'm very, very eager to read it, because even in religious Catholic homes, there's an isolation. And as a young girl, I myself felt this isolation, and I like I so much wanted not to have that isolation in my own family. And it's not perfect. I'm sure that, you know, there are still moments where we are isolated, but I wanted to congratulate you and encourage you in your work, because it's just so much needed. I'm sorry, sometimes I go on these rants, but I wanted to congratulate you on your work and encourage you in your work. And if there's anything that I can do in any way to help, I'm all in. And, you know, sometimes as moms, we forget that in our mothering, that, yeah, maybe at one phase it will be the Life in the Spirit seminar. Maybe in another phase it will be, you know, propagating the rosary. But I do think that now's the time to consecrate our homes during this pandemic and to try to create our homes as a sanctuary that protects our children and radiates love and radiates joy and radiates our appreciation. Like, you know, like kiss your son on the forehead, you know, give your daughter a big round hug. Like sometimes it's a matter of cleaning up the house so that it is a welcoming mm-hmm. environment. You know, they call me at home the Tasmanian devil, because I'm the, like I come into a house and I make a mess and then I have to clean it up again. anyway, I'm sorry for going on and on.
I think that's so important what you said. In the analogy you said about your daughter, I would say what's beautiful about the Sacred Heart is that he reveals so that he can heal. And part of it is having this, the reason why we have to go through the enthronement, we have to honor him, is because he wants to bring healing and hope to everyone. But a lot of times we're too busy being busy, or we're too busy doing good that, you know, we don't know what to do when we find it, right? We can turn to the blind eye and say, I can't deal with that kid's problems. I don't want to look on their phone. I don't want to look at this. But the truth is, when Jesus is parenting with his love, it's gentle. He's gentle. He's kind. He's going to rearrange the furniture of your house, and you got to figure out, oh, you know what? This is better the way it's a little bit louder. It's a little bit messier, but I got a pulse of what's going on. And these kids at least know, hey, you are not looking at a Catholic perfect mom at all. I could line up all the kids and they could tell you all my faults, but they know I'm in the game. And that's why I tell them, I said, Mom, stay in the game. Don't give up. And our enthronement manual I have here, it's simple graphics. It's 3 days of preparation where we encourage 3 days of family prayer. Sometimes it's just the mom and the baby, right? That's where they're at. But somebody's got to do it to get to the enthronement. What we found is, you know, Dorothy, some of the older models of enthronement are fantastic, but they weren't getting to the finish line. They were getting so discouraged with leading up to the enthronement that they didn't say, Jesus, you can come. And Father Mateo used to say, you know what? Light the candle, place the image there, you know, trust in Jesus. Don't get so caught up in, did I do this right? And does this look right? And do I look like the perfect Catholic family? No, just go for it. Run your race and do the best you can.
Yeah. And I think you're like, bang on that. Sometimes you're not going to get the cooperation of your husband. Sometimes you're not going to get the cooperation of your children. It might be you and the candle and the picture of Jesus. But I don't know where I read it or if it was a grace that was given to me. I forget half the time, but that mother's prayers are particularly powerful. And the more that you pray, the more it influences the entire family, whether or not they know it, whether or not you know it. So you are given a particular grace as a Catholic mom. The other thing too, you know, it's probably not going to happen, but if in a million years, Emily, you and I collaborated on a book, there's one issue that comes up over and over and over again in our ministry, is that many mothers have wounds from their own mothers. And that wound from their own mother has left this deep scar, and then they inflict this pain on the next generation, right? And, you know, I guess I always say I could write a book about that, because so many people have written stories. But again, you know, you said it yourself, right? That it's, you know, Jesus Christ is the healer. And all of those wounds that have been inflicted on us, like, you know, I tell people, you know, my Catholic mom, you know, she wasn't perfect. She was, as a 13-year-old girl, pulled out of the rubble during World War II, and she saw her mom lose a baby, and they were both pulled out by Marian priests, and saw the death of, you know, her baby sister. So my mom had trauma issues, right? And so, but I always knew that my mom was in the game and that her heart was in it. And I always knew she went to confession and, you know, and so her heart, like, I always forgave her because I knew her heart was in it, right? The other thing I want to encourage each and every Catholic mom here is never give up on giving your children religious gifts, right? So maybe buy five copies of Emily's book.
Well, and you bring up a very good point real quick, is that who has a more wounded heart, right, Dorothy? Yes. This is interesting. When I wrote the book, the most wounded heart lands in the heart, the wounds of the pains of the disciples who had just totally abandoned him, like ran from our Lord. And we didn't mention this earlier, but what was so powerful, when you go back and read about the Last Supper, what did the Apostle John do? He rested his head right in this terrible moment of stress. He went back, leaned back, and rested his head on Jesus's heart to hear his heartbeat. So that's what we have to do. We have to hear his heartbeat in our life. We have to know that his heart is the most wounded of all hearts, right? Nothing beats Jesus's heart. But what did he do? He exposes his heart to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque. He shows you his wounded heart. And then he says, I love you. And the question is, what do? Oftentimes we cross our arms, we curl in a ball, we get harder, we get angry. No, the difference is we have to extend our arms. We have to pull our babies close to us, but we have to hear his heartbeat. And that's what gets me so excited about, as you mentioned, the wounds, the inflictions, the pains. We can spend months, days, the rest of our life talking about that. But when we look here, doesn't it disappear? It all gets put in perspective, moms, on what your real problems are. And your spilled coffee might be a trial that you think about all day. Your messy house, you're scratching your floor from your child's toy, might ruin your day. But the truth is, don't let it get a perspective. He loves you. And the story you just told, Dorothy, like, your poor mother, right? Your poor mother. But stay in the game and show that grace and love to yourself, to the previous generations, to pray for your children. And don't let the stick of criticism be, you know, your legacy. This is a better legacy, love of Jesus.
Yeah. And what a beautiful, beautiful reminder. There was no one more wounded than Jesus Christ. And, you know, we don't have time to talk about it now, but look at the sorrowful wounds of our Blessed Mother as well. And so, you know, being wounded doesn't mean that we can't be joyful, right? And, you know, the other thing too is I always say that one of the reasons I go back to Mass week after week is because I get wounded through the week. You know, every single day when I now through pandemic, it's been harder to go every day, but it's just like, you know, going to the Eucharist to be healed of all of those wounds, right? And offering that suffering up and uniting it with the suffering of Jesus Christ is can be very transforming. But I just really, really love what you've said about you know, remembering that. Like sometimes I think a lot of women spend time feeling sorry for themselves, thinking like, oh, I was wounded. It's like, yeah, well, grow up then, girl. So was Jesus. That's what's coming to my mind. You know,
but it's all about perspective. And that's the good thing about Jesus's heart, right? Come to me. I am meek and humble of heart. Like he's not like sitting there like sarcastic. He's like, okay, you're wounded. Like that must really hurt, you know, let me heal it. And that's the difference. Once you're healed, then you also have the proper sensitivity to the things that, you know what? I have an aversion to television. I don't like it because I spent so many years doing it, but that's something he's removed from my life right now because I actually can't write books. I couldn't be able to binge watch TV. He needed to remove something to create a space for me to be able to do the work that I do. So he might pull something out of your life, such as television or, you know, your love for social media and or shopping, and he's going to fill it with something so awesome that like starting a mother's group, like, you know, starting a first Friday, you know, going to mass on 9 consecutive first Fridays. Dorothy, I gotta tell you, it's a huge grace. Jesus offers us so much grace by going to mass on the first Friday of the month, because it reminds us of the day that he died. You're honoring him. You're doing an act of reparation. And he even tells us that those who do this first Friday devotion, that he will, you know, that you will not die without the grace of final perseverance, which is without receiving your sacraments. And he says, and my heart shall be their safe refuge at their last moment. So if you don't need any other reason to live out this devotion, who doesn't want his heart to be your refuge at your final moment?
Oh, I think you're calling me out on the carpet here because I've got a little bit of ADD. So I'll do one Friday, two, and then I slip, right? So thanks for the reminder.
Well, I'm right there with you. And that's the gift of Catholic moms is that we get back up. You know what? I will get to month 7 and then my husband and I will like go on a date and I'll be like, oh, I was going to go to evening mass tonight, right? Like I was going to do this. So we all just, but the point, what I realized in writing this book about the promises of the Sacred Heart and secrets of the Sacred Heart, I realized it's not even about the 9 consecutive. It's about getting back up and wanting to practice and love Jesus and the Holy Eucharist and getting to mass for the rest of my life. This is a life journey. This is not, you know, I ran a half marathon and I'm done. This is, you got to stay in the game.
Yeah. And especially, you know, during these times, oh my gosh, it's 3:05. time has just flown right by. Do you have any closing thoughts? Can you mention your website again where people can get your book? Anything you'd like to say in closing?
First, I was going to tell you, the book is published by Ave Maria Press, and they gave me a little coupon code that I just remembered about today. Jaminet 21 for 20% off from the author. So they have some specials going on right before Christmas. So if you're interested, Jaminet 21, you can find me on, as Dorothy and I met on social media, you can find me on Instagram, on Facebook. I'll respond to any of your questions. I would love to hear from you. The book Secrets of the Sacred Heart is really an outreach to get the message out about the enthronement, about our ministry at welcomeisheart.com. There's beautiful videos explaining enthronement. I'll answer any of your questions and know that Catholic moms just keep on being Catholic. And my website is emilyjaminet.com if you want to reach out to me for anything else.
Yeah. So all of you know, I like to end a session with a little song. I'm so glad we had this time together. Just to have a laugh or pray a prayer. Seems we just get started. And before you know it, comes a time we have to say so long. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Susan Taras, one of our new Mother's Group leaders in Chippewa. Claude, thank you for joining us. I don't know whether we're going to have another Midday Mom session before Christmas. I'm not 100% sure. I promised myself I'd give myself a little bit of time off. just because, but you're all on my email distribution list. So if we do have one, I'll let you know. If I don't, I wish you a very, very Merry Christmas, and don't forget to get to confession if you haven't already been. Emily, thank you so much for joining me today. Really appreciate your time. Love you, and congratulations on all of your success and your incredibly, incredibly hard work. You'll definitely be in my prayers. Okay, bye-bye, everyone. Bye now.